Sports on television these last 50 years has grown into a very big business. Networks pay billions for the rights to broadcast the games, and that has changed the way the games are played. Sports on TV is there for your entertainment. And for the last 50 years, sports on Channel 8 has been pretty entertaining, too.
Evening Edition Sports with Jerry Haynes.
Yes, that's a future Mr. Peppermint in the early days doing sports at Channel 8.
We did it ourselves. There was no tar building where the newsroom was. And we just ripped and read and wrote.
In the late 50s and early 60s, Wes Wise was the sports department at WFAA. He even welcomed Tom Landry home prior to the Cowboys' first season in 1960.
Well, it was, Wes. Of course, we've always looked forward to the opportunity of coming back and making our home at one spot the year round.
Of all of the people that I've met in sports down through the years, I probably respect and admire Tom Landry as much as or more than any of them. Still do.
Even Cowboys quarterback Don Meredith did sports for Channel 8 in 1966, but it was Dave Lane, a freckle-faced kid from Fairfield, who was named sports director in 67. He beat out this guy.
Dave aspired to the same thing I did, and he got the job. But it speaks to the kind of person he is that when he decided he wanted to go in a different direction, Dave Lane picked up the phone and called me and said, you know, the job is going to be open. Would you like to apply for it again? He said, I'm not going to be in a position to make the choice, but I want to recommend that you be the guy.
The preparation of the daily telecast, of course, is the most important aspect.
The sports fan.
Of my day's work.
The sports director.
8 or 9 minutes.
Vern Lundquist. Watch News 8 when you really want to know.
WFAA was breaking new ground covering the Cowboys in the late 60s. Back then, you had to be inventive and efficient.
We got to use 800 feet of film per game. Now, it takes, if you shoot every play, and I'm sure it hasn't changed, it still takes 1,600 feet of film to shoot the game from start to finish and not miss anything. But our deal was 800, so in essence, we could shoot every other play and guess. And for 2 years, Jack Murray and I would sit up on Sunday afternoons at the Cotton Bowl. Jack would have the tripod up, and he'd be shooting. And if I had a sense that something might happen, I'd pull his pant leg. And then he'd click the camera on real quick. And then if nothing happened, he'd shut it off real quick. And then I'd wait, and pull his pant leg again. He'd start the camera. We went for 2 years every home game. And we never missed a touchdown. I think it's one of the proudest things to this day.
It wasn't just the Cowboys that stretched Channel 8's technological capabilities. Covering Major League Baseball also began in a rather primitive fashion.
I led the newscast with a phone in my ear. And I was talking to Tommy Vandegrift, who was at a meeting in New York and had called us at Channel 8 to let us know that the Washington Senators were going to become the Texas Rangers. But that was it. That's how we all found out. Tommy speaking like he was in a tin cup out at sea. And things were really primitive.
There are those who swear they could hear Vern coming because of the coats he wore. To say the least, fashion in the 70s was, well, forgettable.
Craig Morton would be his starting...
And this group of guys who ran a place called the Kent Shop got the station to agree. Oh, my God. And I see the pictures of the clothes that I wore. And I'm just embarrassed. I mean, now you think, oh, mercy.
That's a nice jacket, and the white shoes are the perfect touch. Vern Lundquist had an incredible run here at Channel 8 before joining CBS full-time. In 1983, Marty Haig hired me. It's been 16 years, the best 16 years of my life. Taxi!
Where to, buddy?
Channel 8.
Yes, Dale Hansen is moving up to Channel 8. This is Dale Hansen's Sports Special.
Hello, everybody. We do sports from here on Sunday Night Now.
I received $25,000 to attend us in here.
In 1987, Channel 8 won a DuPont Columbia Award and a George Foster Peabody Award for its investigation into the SMU play-for-pay football scandal.
Is that your letter?
It was just one of the major sports stories that Channel 8 brought to the viewers of North Texas.
It's tough when you break a relationship
that we've had for 29 years.
This is Jimmy Johnson's office now.
The Dallas Cowboys and their fans can celebrate being the team of the 90s now.
The seasons of these Rangers weren't celebrated at all until now.
It's taken 25 years, but playoff baseball comes to the ballpark in August.
Woo! Let's go!
Stars won that Stanley Cup. Most people thought they would, and they did. And sometimes that's the hardest thing to do. Finding the time to cover all the sports in this area is harder. There's not a better place in America to be a sportscaster. Every sport at every level, and every day is a different day. I knew a long time ago Dallas was where I wanted to live and where I was going to die. But I'm kind of hoping that's not for another 50 years. Now, there's a show I'd like to do. Dale Hansen and 100 years of WFAA TV.
I'm Troy Dungan. Coming up next, I'll have some of those memorable moments that have made Channel 8 special. And we'll explain what really happened on November 24th, 1992.
Reporting live, I'm Valerie Williams. Back to you, Chip and Tracy.
Thank you very much.
All right, thank you.
Well, the snow hasn't made it as far as North Texas.
This is D.L. Hughley from the Hughley, celebrating 50 years of the spirit of Texas right here on Channel 8.
Someone once said, give nothing but the highest quality to your moments as they pass. In many ways, television is about moments, whether they're historical or hysterical. What we've tried to do here at Channel 8 is make them memorable.
In September of 1964, the Fab Four came to Dallas, and Bert Schiff was at his best. He got an exclusive interview with all four of them. It was Bert and the Beatles on Channel 8.
Thank you.
What kind of girl do you prefer?
My wife.
Your wife.
What kind of girl is she?
She's a nice girl.
Nice.
Is this? Ringo, when you marry, what kind of girl are you going to have?
Oh, I don't know. I haven't sorted one out yet. I like them all.
What?
Yeah, how about that?
How about that, eh?
Ain't that very
really, thank you.
What kind of girl do you like?
John's wife.
I've covered stories in Vietnam, hurricanes, presidential assassination, a couple of school board meetings. You know what I'm going to be known for? The guy that snuck into the Beatles dressing room and got an interview.
They say seeing is believing, Anita, but honestly, I don't believe it.
We did the first chroma key fashion show for a store out of New York called Alexander's Fashion Show. And we had one chroma key camera, and it worked about 5 minutes out of 5 hours.
There were other moments, too, like the time Gene Thomas had to wrestle a tiger on News 8, etc.
Barry, now, wait a minute.
Just let him play with you, Gene.
I don't know about wrestling a tiger, but I have had to wrestle the equipment in the weather center a time or two.
Do I have any visuals, Steve, for the weather? Anybody want to tell me about that? Fine. All right. Well, all right. Let's tell you what let's do. We're going to play this by ear, folks. If you got a camera that'll work, put it on the satellite photograph. You got one that'll do that? Well, that's a map. Anyway, we'll go with that while we look for the satellite photograph. There's a Texas map, folks. And watch this. This is going to kill them. There's this southerly wind coming across Texas here tonight, folks. And yeah, I do too. This is the 5-day outlook. That sucker's right there where I can get to it, too. All right.
There have been positive moments, too, like Wednesday's child segments that have found families for hundreds of children, and toy drives with Santa's helpers each December for almost 30 years.
Well, the cold began to set, and the first place it literally hit was my jaw. And then we move outside, and during that short amount of time, it's not uncommon for both our feet and hands to go almost completely numb. We had this major cold front coming in, and Valerie was on the night shift, and I was the 10 o'clock producer. The first thought that goes through my head is, oh my God. Emerald authorities would certainly be thankful if they could avoid what happened today. I walk in to the newsroom, and suddenly all of my colleagues jump up and they give me a standing ovation. I was floored. I couldn't believe it. Reporting live, I'm Valerie Williams. Back to you, Chip and Tracy.
Valerie, we understand that the wind chill factor out there earlier tonight was 13 below. Sounds like you're having a hard time talking.
There is still not a month that goes by that someone does not come up to me from the public and say, do you remember when you were in that snowstorm?
Thank you very much, Valerie.
All right, thank you.
Well, the snow hasn't made it as far as North Texas.
I laugh now. But it was one of the worst moments of my producer life.
La-dee-da, to spread the news and to keep the spirit alive.
I did not do this. I asked the question.
Did you get good ratings tonight?
High-definition television for Dallas-Fort Worth.
Technological change is one of the miracles of modern television, and Channel 8 is still out front.
Hello, everybody. I'm Chip Moody.
And I'm John McKay, and this special edition of Channel 8 News is the first ever presented in the new high-definition widescreen format.
And because the skies are clear, we will probably drop down into the 20s tonight. The industry and the technology are rapidly changing. We used to write on our weather maps with chalk or grease pencils. Now our graphics are generated with computers, full animation. Regardless of how advanced the equipment is, television will always be defined by its moments.
Hi, I'm Gloria Campos. Next, I'll have the stories about some of the people who have helped build this television station. There are primarily two things that make a television station successful. First and foremost, it's you, the viewer. Our primary mission is to serve you. The other key to a station's success is the people who work there. And those who work here take great pride in their work, and they have for 50 years.
Just a really good group of folks. I told you I'd get nostalgic because they're quality people first. I mean, they're extraordinarily talented people, but they're quality people.
Any chemist will tell you amazing things can happen when you get the right mixture in a bottle. Years ago, WFAA made a commitment to getting the right mix of people together to do amazing things in local television.
I think we all understand that we're making a deal. We're allowed to work at one of the truly great TV stations, and maybe there are not that many left, but we're allowed to work at one of the great ones. And in return for that, we owe each other a level of performance and commitment that goes way beyond what would be expected other places.
To put it frankly, we're in the production business.
Channel 8 was on the cutting edge in local commercial production in the early 1960s. But as the business changed, so did the direction of WFAA. Station manager back then was Ward Huey.
Ward had a vision that the future really for local TV stations, as opposed to the networks, was going to be news and information. And with that vision, he got on the plane, went to New York, and brought back Marty Haig when he came back. And, you know, as you say, and then there's the rest of the story.
It was the luckiest hire I ever made.
He and Marty had an idea of how they wanted to grow.
If Ward Huey saw news as the future, it was Marty Haig who made it happen. He built a newsroom with a unique collection of talent, on camera and off.
They're the greatest staff in the world. There was no plaque on the wall, but there was a mission statement that seemed to be kind of imbued in everybody's heart, if you will, that they understood, well, we're not finished until we do this thing the right way.
He's so smart that I believe he can manipulate any situation and you don't even see it coming. He gets people to do what he wants them to do because they want to do it. And that's the sign of an incredible leader.
If you step away from it and you look at the kind of people who work here day in and day out, they are not only good, but they're very special.
Station manager Dave Lane, who died in 1993, could have been talking about himself. He was special, too. He was the kind of boss who could step on your shoes without ruining your shine.
Dave Lane was management, but he was also human, which isn't always the case. And he was such a good man, and he fostered that feeling of family in the newsroom and beyond.
He was quite simply the finest person I've ever known in my life. And he worked in a tough business. He was a tough competitor, very successful. He wanted to win very badly, but he also understood people and understood the human dimension of life.
Station managers don't usually do TV. They sit and worry about budgets and the bottom line. But Mike Shapiro also worried about the viewers.
He was a fabulous general manager. He was the kind of guy who, more than through research, knew in his gut what worked in his market.
Mike Shapiro was an icon in the industry when the industry needed an icon to represent the local operator, the station, local stations.
He loved me to death. I came here as assistant news director and became news director, and he was so proud of me because I didn't spend any money. And, of course, I didn't have anything, you know. Our reporters were disc jockeys, would-bes, has-beens, never-will-bes. I know one time I got I used to stand outside the Times Herald on Fridays waiting for him to fire a guy so I could hire him.
Bert Shipp is one of the most...